Well, let me begin and just say that, again, it's such a blessing to have you here. I read Lorna's last book, Message of Hope from the Angels, and what struck me about that book is its kindness. And in the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus said, "You'll know them by their fruits." And the fruit of Lorna's engagement and experience with angels is great kindness. And kindness, that in my mind, is from God. And so what she shares is true in the sense that it is godly. Lorna, you see angels physically. And I wonder if you could tell us a little bit about either the first time you saw an angel, or perhaps even what you see right here.
I think maybe the first thing I should tell you is what I'm seeing here today. I've seen the light of the guardian angel behind each and every one of you. And since I arrived in America, actually Philadelphia, at the airport, just seeing everybody, you know, and that light opening on everybody and closing all of the time. And I know that is a very spiritual sign from God that there is lots and lots of hope here in America and for big changes for the positive within America, and that you are seeing that wonderful light of hope within your own lives, even if it's only a little glimmer. And I just have to smile because, you know, I was upstairs in your office and I was glancing out the window every now and then and, you know, just watching all of you coming in. And all this I can say is seeing hundreds of angels following you all of the time. And I have to say, each and every one of you are sitting here and it looks like as if every space is full. But I don't understand myself how angels can sit in between you, separate from your guardian angel. But they're actually doing that. And I'm telling them, you're all after laughing and smiling that time. I'm just saying to them, don't be so serious looking. So I just have to smile at that. And the only other thing I can say is, you know, from the moment I opened my eyes, I saw angels. And you have to remember, I was only an infant, so I didn't know they were angels. And it was when I was about 2.5 years of age, roughly, that when I was playing with my little brother. And I didn't know, you have to remember, because I was only 2.5, that my little brother had died before I was born. But I used to play with him, and sometimes I would see him in my mom's arms as an infant. But again, I was only a small little child. And it was the day that our hands touched. You know, it was like as if his hand went into mine or mine went into his. And you can imagine the reaction of a child, you know, about 2.5 years of age. I laughed. It was so wonderful. And it was then that the angels told me that I must keep it a secret, that they were angels, but that my little brother was a soul, that he had died. And even at that age, which I find incredible, I understood exactly. And the angels have always been my best friends, my companions, my teachers, because in Ireland, way back then, the doctors had branded me with my parents as retarded, because I'm that word I can't pronounce even today, dyslexic.
Oh, dyslexic.
Yeah, that's it. Even today, I don't read very well. So you're probably saying, how on earth did you manage to write these books? But that's another long story. But I suppose the important thing to say to all of you is that each and every one of you, no matter whether you believe or you're skeptic, or what faith you have or religion you have, each and every one of you has a guardian angel that God has given you. And your guardian angel never leaves you for one second. So you're never, never alone, and you're loved unconditionally. But I suppose the other thing is that your guardian angel is the gatekeeper of your soul. And I'm afraid you can't throw that gift away that God has given you. You can ignore it, and you can do your best and deny it. But I'm traveling the whole world now, and I have never seen any man, woman, or child without a guardian angel, and it doesn't matter what religion you are. So I thank God for that.
Thank you. Some of my notes, was it difficult to be a mother, as you talk about being a child, was it difficult to be a mother and someone who experiences angels at the same time?
That's a question I've never been asked before. So I'm saying, what way should I answer it? Well, one thing, I suppose, I'm very proud to be a mother, and that God chose me and blessed my husband and myself with four beautiful children. And, you know, it's just normal and natural for me to see angels every single day, every moment of my life. So I know no different. So in that sense, no, it wasn't really harder. But I did constantly give out to God when things were difficult, and even give out to the angels as well. And being a parent is the most important job in the world, and every parent that has a child should remember that. You know, it's more important than being the president, or, you know, being head of a big company or anything like that. You know, being a parent is the toughest and the most hardest job you ever could have. And it's a huge challenge. And for every parent to remember, like even myself, God used to remind me, you know, constantly, Lorna, what is the most important job of your life? And I would have to turn around and say to God, the children you have given me, and because my children and all of your children are the future of the world. And God has entrusted, you know, children to us. And lots of parents forget that, because sometimes a parent feels a child is a burden, or a child is, even though they love them, you know, regardless of that part, just find it very, very hard. But for every parent to remember that, you know, they're holding the most precious gift in their arms, you know, their child, and their child is the future. And it's all that you teach your child. You teach it to be loving and caring. It will grow up that way. You teach it with, you know, to have faith in God, you know, and to know right from wrong. They're actually simple things. You know, it's not something huge, but it's extremely important. It's the most important job.
When parenting is difficult, as it sometimes can be, and we ask the angels for help, how do the angels help parents to raise their children the way you say?
Well, the first thing I would say to any parent, and I know my hand and all will start shaking because I'm holding this, is, you know, ask your guardian angel to help you, and of course pray, because prayer is extremely powerful. And tell your child about the guardian angel. That is another very important thing, because now I'm hearing from parents all over the world saying that they're asking their own guardian angel, asking God to ask the child's guardian angel to help to look after the child during school, or to get the child, please God, home safely in every way, and making their children aware that they have a guardian angel. And this is people of all religions. Like, I'd be fascinated by that. There's no barriers there. They're being taken down. And, you know, children even saying what a difference it makes to them in school, even if they're being bullied or they're having exams. They're so conscious that the child that's bullying them has a guardian angel, and they're asking their own guardian angel to ask the child's guardian angel to help the bullying to stop, you know. And you hear back from children even a year later saying, Lorna, it worked. And to me, that is fantastic, you know, in that way. So it is to be conscious and aware that you have a guardian angel. And that has been one of the most powerful messages that has gone out to the world since I have written the book, Angels in My Hair.
One of the things in your latest book, A Message of Hope from the Angels, it might be the flip side of parenting, which maybe is child, and I don't know, but you talk about the soul of each child choosing its parents with unconditional love. I just, I was just, that really touched me very deeply that, and even if the child wasn't to live long or at all, the soul chooses that parent and loves that parent. Can you talk a little bit about that?
And that has been another message that has been great help to all parents. You know, that your child chose you to be the parent. And I know there is many adult out there that is probably saying to themselves, how on earth could I have chosen my mother or father to be my parent? Because they're absolutely dreadful, or they're not good parents. But you did, you chose them. And before you came from heaven with your guardian angel to be conceived, to stay in this world, you knew your parents false, but you still chose them. And at that stage, you love them unconditionally. And again, it is important for a parent to remember, even if, you know, a mother is only pregnant for a short while, again, that little soul chose them, but only needed to come for that time. And just think of that, that your child chose you, even though it didn't stay. Or sometimes when a baby is born, or a child only lives for, you know, a couple of years, or, you know, something like that. Just remember that child chose you to be its parent and knew you could look after it. And that message has been great comfort to so many parents around the world, you know, that would say to me, Lorna, I'm tearing the hair out of my head. I'm struggling here. And I suppose maybe to tell you the story, I know it's in the book, A Message of Hope, one story about unconditional love in that sense was, you know, meeting a mother in the hotel lobby and, you know, just seeing all the angels around her and she coming up and she talking to me. I'm skipping loads of it now. And she started to tell the story about her 15-year-old daughter and she had a young son of 12 or 13. And how her young daughter, you know, screams at her, roars at her, has stripped her of her own dignity, her own courage and strength, and how in a sense the mother ended up on, what do you call those tablets to relax you?
Yes.
You know, all of that she had a breakdown. And the mother didn't realize at the time, who else can your child scream and shout at? Who else can your child say to, I hate you? You're the worst parent in the world. It is love that your child is crying out for. And I said to her, as the angels had told me to say, ask her, did she ever tell her daughter she loved her? And the mother looked at me quite shocked, you know, and I'm watching the angels there, and they're distracting me a bit, but the mother looked at me quite shocked and said, but I'm her mother. My mother never told me she loved me, but she was my mother. And I said to her, but your daughter needs you to tell her you love her. You know I could go on with the story, but we don't want to take up too much time. But all this I can say is I met her accidentally, because I didn't know this woman at all. I met her accidentally about a year later or something like that. And time in me is never very good. And I think it was in London or somewhere, I'm not sure. And she had this beautiful young girl with her. And they came up to me and thanked me. And the young girl just said, I was the most horriblest daughter in the world, you know? But love grew between them. And all the daughter wanted to know was that her mother loved her. Material things are not telling your children you love them. You need to actually tell them you love them and be there for them. And if they're saying you're the worst person in the world, you're the baddest mother or father in the world, you know, again, they're still looking for love. That is love. You know, the world is very challenging out there and very frightening for a young person. And they're trying to have all the courage and strength within themselves. But you have to give them love and just let them know you're there for them. It was like I just told the mother what the angel said for her. Every time her daughter said something so horrific like that and stripped her, you know, of her own dignity, for her to just turn around and say to her, I love you. It doesn't matter.
beautiful. Thank you. You mentioned the material and how that sometimes doesn't fill the need to have someone say that they are loved. You grew up in poverty as a child, and from your book, you had no apparent interest in the material world. Do you see any relationship between not having material things and being able to see spiritual?
Again, that's another question I've never been asked. So that is lovely. I'm just watching some of the angels down along the side, and there's a beautiful, I have to tell you, a beautiful angel up on the balcony there, behind everybody. And angels, I have to say to you, are neither male nor female. Just sometimes they give a female appearance or a male, and they give a human appearance within themselves. So we can recognize them. If they didn't, we wouldn't. But that beautiful angel is, what would I say, just holding so many flags. I know there must be other angels behind it, but they're not allowing me to see it. And I think they're trying to cheer the people on here to help you to have more faith and more belief and to hold love in yourselves. So what was your question?
Well, let's see. I'll change it a little bit. In your book, you say, what we bring to heaven are not money and material things, but memories and all the love we felt on earth. Do you think sometimes the material things can get in the way?
Yes. What would I say? You know, that is one thing that has happened in the world, you know, over the last number of years. And to me, it is a miracle in disguise. And I know you probably say, no, it's not. But to me, it is that people have become aware that, you know, material things aren't the most important. And, you know, what I have seen here in America, you know, that light, that awakening, you know, in the sense that everything has been made accountable, but not just here in America, but all around the world.